All right, next up we have a discussion on the FM experimentation.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am Roosevelt Corbett, the acting director of CDN. And this afternoon's discussion will be on the FM experimentation event executed at Fort Lee, Virginia, on the 23rd of March. I can tell you in my 10 years of working here as a combat developer, as a soldier, and a civilian, this is probably the most significant event as far as collaboration within our community, as far as partnership with CAPCOM, we did after some financial management gaps and solutions and possible solutions, and in terms of a definite way ahead to present to our commandant for possible infusion into this campaign. So we go to the next slide. Okay, this is the outline. I think it's important for me to give you the context of experimentation and how it works in the trade-off processes. We'll go over the concept of operation for the experimentation event, talk about the problem statement, the objectives, and the purpose. We'll talk about the outcomes, and the most important part of this briefing will be the discussion. We'll get to the observations, which I will turn it over to Mr. Cole here. And we'll go over the observations, and then we'll also go over the insights. Now, in terms of the insights on the final experimentation report are the basis for .OPFP recommendations going forward. Next slide, please. Okay, we missed one slide here. Okay, so can you go back one? It's not in here? Okay, so I did have a slide. I'll briefly explain to you how experimentation works within trade-off. So basically, you heard General Hornback talking about the national military strategies, the chief of staff's priorities, and all those other strategic documents. Well, within TRADOC, those strategic documents determine new required capabilities. And we bump those required capabilities up to our current capabilities, and we look at those gaps in terms of tasks, identify those gaps, and come up with possible solutions. Now, in TRADOC, there are two processes that those new required capabilities are infused into TRADOC. It's through the Army Capstone concept, as far as the doctrine, the Army operating concept, and the six functional concepts throughout trade-off. On the other side, when you're talking about .OPFP or material solutions or non-material solutions, the science and technology and all the other experimentation events and all the other processing systems, these are possible recommendations as far as what we call the capabilities-based assessment. And once we do that capabilities-based assessment, and that assessment determines warfighting requirements, it can either be in terms of non-material or material solutions. So if it's a material solution, it'll go again in the defense acquisition system. And if it's a non-material solution, it'll go back to the representative, to the requisite centers of excellence, or possible solutions. So what we're doing with our experimentation, we're taking experimentation out of the what we call the level one process, where it goes across all centers of excellence. We're taking our experimentation event and those .OPFP recommendations for action within our own course. So this slide talks about the purpose of experimentation. And the purpose of experimentation is simply this, just to learn. And so I wanted to show you this slide. This slide is coming straight out of TRADOC regulation 7120. And I want to talk to you about this slide because I want to first get you to have a great understanding of all the work that went into this event. So we probably started actually planning for experimentation back in October. So you can see the three event work sessions up here. We've done all of that. Probably about 20 people, 20 personnel dedicated to the SSI from the Financial Management School, my senior director, and about another 10 or 15 from the Sustainable Data Lab at CAPCOM participated in planning for this debate. So you see the learning demands, the analytical issues, the execution, and the two facilitators, Colonel Horner and Colonel Forsythe, did a great job of facilitating our readiness for this debate. So at the end state, here's where we are right now. At the end state, we're doing our post-analysis. We have a copy of the draft experimentation report, and we're looking at, we're refining that report by Thursday. We're going to give that report once we finish. We'll give that report to Colonel Horner. Colonel Horner's going to send it out to select members of the finance board for possible review and implementation. And so from that, we will look at possibly infusing relevant solutions, recommended solutions into the FMS campaign. Next slide. So this is the problem state. And the problem state simply says we need to examine our mission command structure. We need to examine roles and responsibilities. One piece that was very important in this experimentation event, and what we got from those emerging trends and those strategic strategies, is that this event was held in the context of large-scale combat operations. And so it was very easy to see at the surface that we had some gaps as far as optimal PFT within the concept of large-scale combat operations. So you can see the purpose, you can see some of the objectives, mission command, roles and responsibility, service gaps, right? You can see that combo 2, combo 3, train readiness, focus site, combo 2, combo 3, those were some of the objectives that we listed, and we worked hard to refine these objectives so we can get to that 3-day event and get to the point and get the focus on our event. Any questions? So I will say again that when we looked, I didn't put, for the purpose of simplicity, I didn't put any concept of operations slides for this event, but it was a multi-core pipe, multi-division. And so when we dove in and we identified gaps, it was easy to see that we had our risk command alignment was off, our roles and responsibilities were not clearly defined. We understand that we had to work with our doctor. We understand that there's some new development issues that we have. So the one piece that we understood on up front is that we did not, this event kind of illustrated that we did not leverage, we are not leveraging our senior financial management tactical and technical capabilities as in our current force structure. Next slide, please. So these are our learning demands. And our learning demands and trade-off processes are simply this. They are questions that we want to have investigated. So we took about a month to come up with these learning demands. Number one, maneuver sustainment commanders, how do we maneuver as sustainment commanders, leverage and synchronize financial management strategic integrators, and enable financial management operations. So you'll see in one of the pieces that was talked about at the event was what's the role of the use of income going forward for the large-scale operations. Number two, what are the responsibilities of TSC, ESC, and sustained financial management roles and responsibilities? What are the commanders' responsibilities in our current force structure from a logistics standpoint? And number three, what FM command alignment and force structure enables commanders at Echelon to accomplish business success? Number four, the training readiness piece. And number five, we talked about a little bit about situational understanding. Next slide, please. So these are the event participants. We actually had finance manager representation at Echelon. We did have a person from a deputy ticket director from OCSA CASCOM attending. We had two sustainment brigade commanders attending. And we had, you can see the other senior leadership and a different participants. Now, for those that did not physically come to the board meeting, during our prep and our planning work, they did participate via telecon. So even though they, some people or some organizations did not physically attend, they've been at board meeting, they actually had input. Next slide. So the focus areas are actually where the actual JDX
come up here for
that were facilitated by Colonel Forsythe and Colonel Hearn. You look at operational readiness, contingency planning, as far as center theater, economic and infrastructure development, and integrated communication. How many here are familiar with Evan Rio? Okay. So there's not, of course, at that level, there's not a lot of language about financial management operations. But I can tell you this, in Chapter 8 of FM3O, you look at the six stability tasks, the one task about supporting economic infrastructure and development talks specifically about financial management responsibility. So if you're not familiar with FM3O, I think it's very, very prudent that you get familiar with 3O. And see, and our challenge is this as a finance management community. When we look at the strategic documents, and we look at FM3O, and all of those FMs and those documents, documents above us, you're very rarely going to see any mention of financial management. But what we have to be smart enough to be able to read that document and understand, as a community, what our required capabilities are. So you can see the focus areas, you can see the learning demands. We have four urgent themes. We've been our 27 preliminary observations into leader development, training management and doctrine, talent management, and force cultural organizations. Any questions so far? Next slide. So this is what we call our check on learning. You can see to the left our set of objectives in terms of the conop that I showed you earlier. And the bottom is our focus areas. When we talk about our index, you can see the observed themes and those green buttons kind of give you an understanding of where our observations were being as far as those things. So now, if you don't have any questions, now is the part that we're going to kind of discuss our observations, and Mr. Cole is going to lead that discussion. Next slide, please.
I just have a quick question.
Yes, sir.
So the green dot, does that mean that
go back.
Good?
No, that means that there's an observation that hit that bin.
Okay.
So there's definitely something, for instance, effectiveness of mission command structure. So we have observations of new development, doctrine, and force structure limitations.
So you have to go back and work on those.
Yes.
Can't hear me, just do something like this and I'll speak up a little bit more. So before we get into observations, I don't want to just ask a basic line question to say, who didn't know about the financial management experimentation until they got here this week? See, that is what as a community we got to get past is communication. If you're not fired up about this experimentation, if you're not involved about what affects your future, then shame on you. I'm here to tell you that there's a lot going on that affects what you want, that's what's been going on over the last 15 plus years that transforms the things that you've done. This is your financial management core. Lived it, done it, seen it. So this financial management experimentation is very important. If we want to get back after the finance brigades, battalions, and companies, everybody in here has to be a part of us getting there. Not just the senior leaders, not even scaring away the junior leaders. Everybody in here has to carry that message. Now getting to the observations. What you have to understand about the observations, there were plenty of concerns, there were plenty of challenges, and there were plenty of issues. But in order to have an observation, several participants have to have the same observation to be recorded effectively to validate an observation to move forward on. Everybody understand what I'm saying? So if Private Cole raised his hand and said, I didn't like training at the detachment level, and I was only one person who said it, and it probably was just a concern. And believe me, we probably had about 400 or 500 concerns. So what you're probably thinking, you probably captured it, it's probably just not an observation. So what we're gonna do, these next four slides are really gonna be critical on your discussion, because they're gonna be observations from the four themes that we kept. I'm not gonna go through each observation, but I will go through some critical ones. So let's go through the first observation. And at any time you have any questions, you can stop and we can have this discussion on it. Training management has atrophied over the last 15 years. We just talked about this. And junior leaders do not possess the doctrinal understanding of how to plan, manage, coordinate, synchronize, and conduct collective training. That was a critical observation that was mentioned by several leaders during this experimentation. Any questions, any comments, discussions? Any yes, no, wow, yes. So I want to go to the third one. Sustained brigades do not possess the requisite skill set, staff to technically train the FMSU and the FMSD. Is that true? Lived in, believe in. We have to move forward with this. What's really important about these observations is these observations have to be our recommendations at the end. We'll talk about this to solve the problem or have the solutions to the problems that we want. So go to the fifth one. Use the fifth of training requirements for FM units to be synchronized through the Army G3, a four-star G3 challenge. Did we have that discussion a little bit earlier yesterday? But we know that there's someone that has to synchronize all financial management, or else we're going this way, and this way. We have to have someone that's doing that. Is it use the fifth of, are there resources for it? Our recommendations to these observations is very critical. So I know everyone's saying, well, how are we going to get there? The way we're going to get there is our recommendations, and that's chapter 3 of the ETAP that we're going to be writing. So you'll keep hearing us say that. And the final one, when we talk about 39 training days, do not enable combo 2 and 3 soldiers to accomplish, maintain certification in level 1, 2, 3, and CPE requirements. Well, not the CPE requirements, but I can tell you right now, 365 days haven't been letting that action component reach their training requirements based on what I heard today and what I've been hearing. So we do have to get back across the board to how we train, how we fight, regardless of what compo we're in.
Next slide. I have a question. Yes. So for the first one, was there any discussion on whether or not that was something that was observed pretty much across the force, or because that seems like something that would not be specific to financial management communities.
You're right. This experimentation was geared towards financial management units. It was identified specifically for financial management units, but it's a generic statement. You're right. It's attributed across the force, not just our community. Sustainable community, combat arms, the new forces, and they're all big with this too. So this was geared towards advocates.
Well, even if I want this a little bit more, what was good about it was it gives us the opportunity during our recommendations to kind of say something specific about what we're going to go with.
And I think, looking at it from my experience, and as the Army was operating under our regime, you know, you really have a lot of time, a lot of life skills from this training. But, you know, so your unit comes back to home station, you come into command, you got personnel PCSing, then you're already on the 50th deploy. So that, you're right, that is, that was an Army, that is an Army dog.
I have one comment. We're looking at all these, a lot of these seem like problems that are above my level to solve. Except for that one that says FMSU commanders are not consistent with belt training. Everything else might be something that we need to go get help with. But that one seems like one, that's an indictment on ourselves, and that's something that we should be able to solve like that. That's, we should fix it and cross that line.
Yeah, but number four is a symptom of number one. Or result of number one. And there were events in there, which is every day commander, that said, guard and Fusen ran right on his head. Did you tell him you had a problem with training?
No.
What's your status? Well, he never talked about it. And there's a disconnect. There was a lack of communication. They never submit a training plan to their STB or get mandatory requirements some of these units for the Fusen to agree that the QTB, STB is rated instead. And the Fusen commander not talking to the STB commander. Basically, we talked about it here. I think two commanders need to step up and take responsibility for the shooting. And then we talked about the certain thing too. Everyone's relying on each other to come ad hoc OST to train certified units. That's been the fallback answer. What OST is going to come down and train our folks? Why should I do that? That was from both. I don't know if the finance manager could have said that, but it was kind of there. Every unit commanders literally said it. Why should I train your units when you bring in this team called the OST? That's going to train your forces. I don't have to worry about it.
Right, and just remember as well, I'll get to you in the next question. Just remember, you can't slam that in experimentation. We could have said, well, we could fix a lot of things that were brought up as an observation. But if you slant the observation and say, well, you want to hear things that don't affect us, or we're not telling ourselves, it's not a true validation of an experimentation. So we didn't want to paint it or even prepare it that way. Next question, Captain
Bond.
I
is this not the same argument as the 6-0 that wound up with the argument and stood back up? Because we've got the top line as far as number one. Number three, that was the argument, wasn't it? That as far as their argument came to, they didn't have the requisite skill set and staff to technically train their people at that entry grade level and start to see the break off. So I see it kind of in the same line as far as why they broke away from the BCT module. We're back to the
right. I think, again, these observations kind of lend to our solutions. Well, that kind of supports where we want to go for sure. And I think that, as you just stated, the same type of embattlement, I would say, that we're having. And they see some of the things, or some of the new reports see some of the same things with them. And that's why when we write chapter 3, we're going to make the direct recommendation for us. But this is still observation from training management and doctrine. So financial management doctrine does not clearly differentiate resource management and finance operations. We talked about that. We know within our doctrine, it's a doctrinal problem. So we don't even have to labor on that. We already know that our doctrine needs to be rewritten. It needs to be rewritten across the board for different reasons. And when the time comes for the doctrine and the writing to come out and ask for everyone here to take a look at it and make sure it's right, do so. Because I can remember back in 2007, 2008, when the doctrine came out, and we got the doctrine we have today, nobody really had the time out in the field to look at it. So when it comes out this time, do the whole financial management for financial management community and their favor.
Hey, see, I just wanted to inject something here. Right now, here's what we're doing in the doctrine. FM3O is out, right? So this is Anderson Investments. Their intern are on an expedited timeline. Writing up in the portal. So they're synchronizing their portal with Brio. In turn, we have halted rewriting all of our document publications on the FM and HR side until FM portal is completed. And we will nest our FM 106 with FM portal. So we're writing that in the portal with FASTCOM right now. And so that timeline right now, the expedited timeline is to have it a final draft done by next month. So we will halt what we're doing with FM 106, and we will do a total rewrite and FM 106. And we really, really, really need your support and the operators out in the field to make sure we get it right this time.
Okay, and the second observation, I think we talked this enough, but we all obviously know that the roles and responsibilities we used to have on are not defined, are not documented, and it's most definitely not in our documents. So as we move forward, and I think this was really a great observation across the board, see who's that strategic synchronizing organization, because let's think about this. So if you have three different organizations thinking they can synchronize your footprint, your mission, they're going to have some problems. I think that's caused some problems. But I believe that we can lay this out as a recommendation, a strong recommendation, and we'll get that from Yusuf Fembaum, exactly the roles and responsibility to go in doctrine, not just the FM 106, doctrine. And I heard that earlier. We normally kind of focus on our doctrine after we look at solutions, but it has to be in the Army doctrine across the board, not just one doctrine. And I think that was a slight problem too. If you're going, look, so many disconnects in doctrine. And I'll be honest and I'll be truthful up front. You know, being a finance retired colonel, I didn't look at doctrine as much as I did. I looked at our doctrine, but I didn't look at everything else until I started getting challenged. And then when I went back to when I was challenged, I went back to look at things and see what did it say. And then I couldn't believe what I was reading. So you have to do your own homework and you have to do your own blame practice in order to stand by what we say from a finance commandment perspective. And that's what we should do, yes.
Can you provide a little clarity in the
bullet
three? What level of GA are you talking
about? Well, at every level. The experimentation that we started talking about, disconnecting doctrine, because when we had explicit arguments about who was responsible or accountable, what did that mean? So, you know, again, not that we have a crisis, we're not saying that, but we have some challenges. So, as a GA, well, I couldn't be responsible for financial management operations because I don't do the finance ops part. I can report that back to my commander, and I can give him, I can go talk to the FO side and say, hey, what's going on, and then take that message back, but I'm not responsible. Well, what about accountable? I could be accountable, but I'm really, you know, you're talking about accountable funds or what? So then, no, I'm not the singular responsible person. So we sit back, I think it was a long dialogue over that, thank you, I really was.
Yes.
And we, it needs to change the document. It needs to be clearly defined on what responsibility, what responsible means, and who is truly responsible.
So I thought it was wrong because it states that GA echelon is singularly responsible for financial operations. And so that's not correct. So we don't get that.
And what we kind of found out is that finance rights doctrine is based on so much of finance missions and procedures and command and control we got used to it. Instead of writing from the Army perspective, and that's command. You know, it's sit in the arson and live. You know, you have someone say, well, you're not commanding me, you just want me to do this. Yet, it's just how the commander, TSC commander, wants to command his forces that he has under people. Any questions about this observation?
I just wanted to comment that the key for experimentation is to identify.
Recommendations, we want to answer these observations because this is clearly a observation that were brought up. So the lack of time management at Echelon that places the right FM personnel, which are references skill sets in a critical FM position. And that was a lot, just a lot to talk about the ESC's fault. You know, that was a big topic. So we're putting, supposedly not putting the right person in that position. And then, you know, we can argue that we utilize it enough.
So we got to
find out. So it depends on how you look at it and that observation. Yeah, did you take over that one? Borrow military manpower to raise the effectiveness of the FM soldier and FM unit ratings. So that was again from a combo 2 to 3 perspective. So you would get a different MOS within your footprint rating that your unit rating to deploy. So who would just take any more manpower and put them in your unit to say that they're experts and now they have to move out to deploy them? So that was something for who's managing them? Well, for all combos, so that was another question, observation. And a third observation, there is limited FM ops training courses your personnel can complete prior to being assigned to a critical position. So let's think about this, and we kind of had this round the table debate. Can you get your skill sets and your positions about the jobs you take, correct? So if you're a lieutenant, you're going to be in a lieutenant position, so you better do well in that. So if you move up to detachment commander, you're going to do well in that job. Then you're going to go off to school. You're going to go off to school, and you're going to go to career course. Career course will prepare you for command. Command is an SA. It's posted. So then you go to that next job. You don't have a special finance skill set course over here to the side and say, I'm going in to be a commander and go to that course for 8 months.
No,
they're asking that question. So, you have to go out, learn as much as you can, to be a multifunctional financial manager, be prepared for those next positions, or, when you get back to talent management, then as we have discussed, then you'll be placed in those correct positions accordingly. Any questions on talent management?
Sir, in order to just to elaborate a little bit more on number two, number three, from the economic presentation, I don't know if I want to state what I want to say, but the issue that we've been having is more on the combo two, combo three. If you're having like an FMSC director apparently went forward and it was like an AP or something like that. So we brought the I think it was the division DA background presentation about the division DA. There was some downside of financial management. So those are like the type of issues that we start bringing in during the economic presentation. But those actually observations, they came from actually the combo two and combo three. I think it was from the deputy from your side, sir. But those are probably more of the issues when it comes to FMSCs, FMSU. And I believe that part of the FMSC, FMSU is having the FMSU on the National Guard side, but the FMSC was on the reserve component side. So those are the other things that we were talking about in the alignment.
Any other comments?
Yeah, just another comment on that comment piece was what we were finding out in the field was sample gave leaderships were either not allowing financial managers to do their job at what different levels. So for instance, the software class was prohibited from being an active commander because they didn't have two defensive holds at a permanent profile. So that was one. The other one was, we talked about it earlier, lieutenants and captains being assorted in non-36-hour positions. So that was, within the same regime, being company SOs, company commanders,
so
that was the other issue we brought up.
And there's one more piece that the sustainable headquarters to make it healthy for off sergeant running through the sergeant. Yeah, that's right.
Next slide.
Yeah.
We're pretty much done. Way finance officers and this is so to make sure about the same. And in my mind, it appears that
significant risk potential of that. So I don't know how we communicate the risk associated with doing that to kind of determine to take those actions, but it's important we communicate there's a risk associated with this that they don't understand that this is a catastrophic effect at some level in our brains, and there's nothing to deter them from doing that. So we're having this conversation in isolation.
Right. You love because you're on the senior leaders, you're respected insulation. Pretty Johnson.
Right.
And then you gotta carry the water. I've been carrying it, I carry the ball, and then to you, you gotta carry it, gotta educate the next generation of sustainers just like we can.
And you need to see if we can quit covering up those potential downfalls that we have downrange. When I used to go out as the OST and then even as the FMS director, and I said, well, what problems do you have? So sustainer brigade commander, TSC commander, thought they didn't have not one problem. Not one problem. So we've been covering it up, because there's a lot of problems. So then it was hard to debate the proven data that they didn't have. Well, how many loss of funds have we had down the theater since this transition? You want to answer that, Les? I raised his hand, but hey, you probably got to answer, man.
It's okay. So if they want truck driver, and they want stuff they can move. So the 36 is only to be accounted for. We only had one master sergeant. We can tell them, hey, all we have is a first sergeant. We need one for IC. That don't even matter. Those things don't matter when it comes to the sustainer. They want to move. They want to have the water. The finances is very, very small. And when, as it goes up to the division, 36 is nowhere on the paper. Nowhere.
Okay, I'm going to hold this discussion up and count up by time, and I can clearly see there's a lot about this, but let's actually get this outcome drop real quick, and then we can get to what the way it is so everybody knows what we're doing. So this last observation for the force structure limitations, this is what was most important, to get the brigades, battalions, and companies back. So we have identified these observations. We will have strong recommendations to move forward. And they have been recommended for brigades, battalions, and companies. So are there any questions about any of these observations? Okay, next slide. So the insights just mirror six insights that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, it should be six. They mirror exactly what we're gonna do with our chapter 3 write-up and recommendations to our four teams, and we will have strong recommendations on the way ahead. And at this point, next slide.
So the bottom line here on the experimentation action plan, recommendation, the organizational recommendation is for us to revert back to the finance transfer brigades, battalions, and companies. Okay, so this chart gives you a poem of what we're going to do, the timeline of putting an FDU junior together. An FDU junior means no bill payers. Within our organization structure to bring back the brigades, the battalions, and companies. So we're right here, the formal report is written. Kind of depict all of the actions that need to be taking place within the FDU. So the one piece that we're gonna have to be really, really detailed on is the operational organizational concept paper. So it has to be detailed to identify roles and responsibilities so it can eventually, at the end of the day, it will inform our FM-106 rewrite. And so, items in red are ARCIC staffing and the Vice Chief Staff approval. And without bill payers, implementation date will be FY20. So that's the timeline. The other piece I would like to tell you is that without bill payers, and understanding that there's going to be a requirement for low-density MOSs, there's going to be a requirement for life support, there's going to be requirements outside of 36. We're going to have to write dependency statements in this FDU where we can depend on other organizations for life support in other areas. So with that said, that's all I have. Next slide. Any questions? I mean, we have a report. I have a report.
And okay, 60 days. I give you 60 days.
Yep. We got it.
Okay.
We got it. We got it. So we're going forward. We're going forward.
You're on the ball.
Thank you.
Were multiple courses of action for how to do the structure looked at, or was there just one?
Yes, they're going.
Could I see that?
We're not there yet.
Okay.
We're not there.
That leads me into kind of like beginning. So this is transforming the financial management community, our structure and everything. So if you're not involved in this, if you don't have a say in this, then you're gonna be just like we're sitting here now saying, who did it? Why? How? What for? So
thanks, really helpful. Thanks. You probably said more than once, and I apologize up front if I missed it. But with respect to the no bill payers versus the bill payers approach to this, was that directive guidance or is that an assumption?
Yeah, that's directive guidance. So anything that we put forward in FDU is the current environment, no bill payers. That means the rule of that is currently if there's a bill payer strategy,
that's a trade-off in both. proposed limitation, not headquarters to 8%?
I think it's headquarters to 8.
And then G357 FM?
I'm not using that.
G357?
You've got priorities in your sequence, and that's where.
So, sir, you bring up a good point. I think the guidance by the Army shrinking. So I think it may be a good idea for somebody in a key leadership position to go back and ask.
Pregnancy statements are risky. That's why I've got to do some pregnancies.
Absolutely, but I think it's just only me. As much as I want to turn it to a game tomorrow, I also don't want to do this fast in it at if there's some flexibility where, hey, you know what, we do have a little bit of growth, maybe it's a percentage, but it might be useful to just go back and ask our whole layout flag to make sure that I think it's an operating guidance.
So we work. When we write an FEU, we write an FEU in a by the total requirement. So if we can't get there, we got to understand the risks. So when we write our FEU, we're going to write the total requirement and one of the course of action. But we also have to write